We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take the law, we enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is March 31st, 2016, the last day of March. Tomorrow is April Fool's Day. So remember that if somebody is playing a joke or, well, you wouldn't know, but I mean, if somebody is acting like they're playing a joke or saying some, fucked up shit or something that you don't believe. I don't know the history of that holiday, April Fool's Day. Obviously, a fool came up with it. It's a stupid fucking holiday. It's like, what was that show with Ashton Kutcher? Punked. It's like Punked Day. That was a dumbass fucking show, too. Anyway, thank you for listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. And you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. And to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, and SoundCloud. And you can also find the show on Stitcher probably the next day. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, what we focus on is promoting the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want, as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, as well as exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without, and I emphasize without, consent by threat of force and violence, because we'll be talking about that today, about consent and a little about the social contract. I think in the future I'm going to do a show, a whole show on the social contract and the philosophers during the Enlightenment and their thoughts on not just the social contract, but liberty in general, Locke and Rousseau and Hobbes. Tonight, we're going to focus more on this article and my opinion on the social contract and my comments. And, of course, your comments on the social contract are welcome. If you'd like to call in, 702-470-7664. Again, that's 702-470-7664. Or you can Skype into the show, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Just send a contact request with your name, what you want to talk about, and we will accept it and bring you on the air. And, of course, you'll sound a lot better on Skype than you will on the phone. So along with that, because this is kind of last minute I added this because I came across this article yesterday. I've been wanting to talk about it, and I was unsure exactly how I wanted to fit it in. But it has to do with Hillary not becoming president. And Drudge, it actually said something about the social contract. I think the title, what they do on Drudge's title or the articles, they give them their own titles and they take other articles essentially from other publications and then just give it a title and then you link to that article. I don't believe that they have any original articles. They may have a few, but that's really what Drudge is. It's a pretty good fucking idea. I mean, from what I understand, the guy's a millionaire, and really all he does is go and find articles to link to. Now, I don't think that's how he started, because I know he broke the story with Bill Clinton and Monica Lewinsky, So I think he started as more of a journalist, but now it's, you know, you still got to, I guess, find those articles. And maybe some of those articles, he has people that write for other publications, or he owns some of those publications or websites. I don't know. I'm not an expert in Drudge. But the way the Drudge Report website is set up is it just links to other articles. Anyway, that was the title. And then you start to read the article and you're like, well, what the fuck does this have to do with the social contract? But I'll get to what it has to do with that in a minute. The other thing we're going to talk about tonight as well, and we talked a little about this in the past, but I'm going to get into more detail and encompass more of it, is happiness and finding happiness within a society where freedom does not exist, or true freedom does not exist. And you realize that, along with realizing all of the other things that are going on, and how you balance happiness and love and having a loving relationship with the fact that you know you're not free and you live in a society that is oppressive. And wherever you live, pretty much that's what it is, I guess, unless you own your own island somewhere. I know Geraldo owns an island, but I don't think he can just live on his island, and it's probably not that big. He said he paid under $1 million, or right around $1 million. I don't know how much of land that is. But I guess there's a lot of islands out there that are pretty small. I don't know how – well, I do know, but in reality, or in how they get away with it – well, I do know that too, but – basically, conceptually, that's what I'm looking for, is how all these countries and the U.S. can claim all these little islands like they do. Because who the fuck, what right do you have to it? You just, this is mine. Which is pretty much what they've done, what every country's done, or every government's done. Depending on how you define country and government, to me, it's the same thing. I don't see a difference. I know there's people that separate that and say, you know, I love my country, but not my government. Well, explain to me the difference, because I've never heard it explained before. Now, I believe I know what they mean, sort of, but I've never heard anyone who's made a statement like that actually explain the difference between government and country, because a country is the I'm trying to think of the word I'm looking for. It's a product. Thank you, self, even though it took you about a minute to think of that. A country is a product of the government. It's not the country comes first and then the government. Now, the people can be in a geographical area, but that's not a country. It's not a country until there's a government, and then they name it and call it a country. And that's, in my opinion, how it becomes a country in the first place. So, you know, talking about an area and the people, and that's a little different. You can say, I love the people in this area, and I love this area, and I love the land, and I love the palm trees. But to say you love the country is no different, in my opinion, than you love the government. And most of the time, it's you love the founding documents of the government. You just don't like how it's operating now, and that's what they mean when they talk about loving the country but not the government. And a true patriot stands up for their country against the government. So I guess in that context, it's the standing up for the original Constitution, I guess. I don't know. I've never heard anybody explain it. Anyway, we'll talk all about that. We'll talk about all the challenges of being a person that believes in true freedom and liberty and knowing all these things and then trying to live a normal type life with a family especially if kids are involved, and how you handle that, along with relationships and being happy. So we're going to talk about all that tonight. Hopefully we can fit it in to the 2 hours I've shortened the show to, at least for now. And again, you are welcome to join the conversation, 702-470-7664. Again, 702-470-7664, or Nonpartisan Liberty for All on Skype. Also, check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. You'll find all our links to our Facebook pages. We have a few. Twitter, various articles, also some archives. I'm trying to – I got behind on the archives, but you can find every show we've ever done, and it will be 2 years in April, so not officially on April 1st. It will be 2 years, but towards the end of April will be 2 years we've been doing the show, and every show we've ever done is posted on Spreaker. So you can go to Spreaker and listen to a lot of terrible shows, but – some great guests in between some of those terrible shows. So people like Adam Kokesh has been on, of course, Ian and Mark of Free Talk Live. Dana Martin, who's been on, I want to call him Mr. Ed, but Dr. Phil. I don't know why Ed came to my is Stephanie Murphy of Pork Therapy. A lot of different people that have been on there. Pete Ayer of Cop Block, one of the co-founders of the main Cop Block, not one of the regional Cop Blocks, Cop Block itself. Pete Ayer and Adamo Freeman have founded that. So there's a lot of good guests and pretty good interviews. Of course, I give that to them because they had interesting stories to tell. And I had – it gave me more interesting questions to ask as their story unfolded. So a lot to listen to there. So regarding the social contract, there – I believe it was on the 29th. There was an article on the Drudge Report. And I check that because – I wouldn't consider them, I know they're called conservative. I wouldn't consider them conservative. However, I would say they lean more conservative than being libertarian. But they do cover a lot of stories about surveillance and police and things like that. So they have had stories on there that I wouldn't consider something conservative support, put it that way. So anyway, I saw a headline. As I mentioned, they give their headlines. And the article was from CNBC. But the headline was, I can't remember the exact words, but it said something about social contract. The social contract is broken or something like that. So, of course, I'm like, oh, let me look at this and see what this says. So I open it and I see Hillary Clinton cannot win U.S. election. I'm like, well, what the fuck does Hillary Clinton have to do with the social contract? I'm like, I'm sick of fucking all the politicians I've been watching. I haven't seen Hillary in a while, though, because they've been covering. It doesn't seem like the Democrats have been out as much. They probably have, but there's just more attention on the Republican race, I guess. So I've seen more of the Republicans. Plus, there was always more of them. So it was more interesting to watch a debate with more people. And the Democrats, they got down to two pretty quick. So I've watched both, but I haven't watched anything with Hillary in a while, and she kind of makes me sick. They all make me sick, so what's the difference? I actually, a couple days ago, heard Ted Cruz talk about a man ask a question. They did a town hall, and I mentioned that I watched the town hall, and Donald Trump comes on with his arrogance. But Ted Cruz answered a question regarding making prescription painkillers even harder to get. And they're really hard to get as it is. And this guy's son OD'd, but he OD'd because I think he started doing other drugs and shit. And you don't know how many people that OD because they wanted to, because they wanted to kill themselves. So to say that they OD'd from a specific drug, and heroin, I can definitely see how you can OD. You're buying it on a street and you don't know what you're getting. With prescription painkillers, although they should talk about the specific ones that they're dealing with, because I don't think anybody's ODing off 10 milligram Vicodin. It's like I heard like 80 milligram like Oxycontin or something, like Jesus. So if anybody's ODing, I'm sure that's what they're ODing on. But of course, he mentions, and it doesn't mean he's going to do it. He might just be pandering to this guy because his son was a veteran, and that, oh yeah, we're going to crack down more on that too. And it's like, yeah, so the people that are in pain, of course, you know, make it impossible for them to get something. Never mind the fact that all drugs should be legal, and if somebody ODs, they made the choice to take those medications. And you usually when somebody ODs, it's not, you know, there are accidental overdoses, but it's usually because they're abusing it or they tried to kill themselves. It's not a lot of accidental overdoses. I guess it would depend on the drug. Like if you're taking, I don't even know if they make these, but like 100 milligram Percocet or something, it'd be a lot easier to OD on that by accident. But the whole idea that the government needs to protect you, I'm so fucking sick of this shit. It's everything. It's when you listen to these debates or these town halls or these motherfuckers talk, it's all about them ruling over you and what they can do to control your life even more. I don't hear anybody talking about, we want to get rid of this shit. I don't hear anybody saying we got too much government. Even the fucking Republicans. I guess Ted Cruz says it, but then, of course, saying it and then when it comes to specific issues, you want to add more government. You want more border control. You already got people. Nobody says, I wish somebody asked the question, why do you got fucking border agents stopping people within the United States? Don't you think that's violating people's rights? No, that's fine with the Republicans, but they support freedom and liberty. They're all full of shit. And we'll talk about that next week, how conservatives, liberals, progressives, Democrats, Republicans, whatever the fuck you are, it's all the same. Well, unless you're, you know, you believe in freedom and you're an independent and you know all this shit. But besides that, it's all the same. So anyway, I saw the article and at first I was just like, you know, did I click on the right article? So I even went back and was like, what the fuck? Okay, so it did have a semicolon. I know. I think semicolon is like a period and a comma and then the comma underneath. It had the two periods. I forget what that's called. So call me retarded, whatever. But then it says libertarian. So I'm like, okay, well, what the fuck does that mean? So let me read this article. I'm saying this is what I'm thinking in my head at the time I read the article. Now, what this motherfucker who's supposedly a libertarian, and I'm not a libertarian, I'm not an anarchist, I'm not none of these things, because, again, people define them however they define them. And everyone defines them differently, not their real definition. And I don't speak for anybody else besides myself. So you can call fucking my beliefs nonpartisan liberty for all-ism or whatever. But I believe in true freedom and liberty. I say what I believe in at the beginning of each show. I said it 5 minutes ago. I think you should be able to do whatever the fuck you want as long as you don't directly interfere with somebody else's freedom. You have to respect other people's freedom to be able to have freedom. Because obviously, if you're attacking somebody else's freedom or interfering somebody else's freedom, then you can't have freedom in general. Meaning that if everybody's out there interfering with everybody's freedom, there's no freedom. That's where they try to say, well, in order to protect freedom, we need the government and whatever, because without that, that's what would happen. Now, I don't obviously believe that. And the government does not just have stick to that ideology that I just mentioned, that you can do whatever you want as long as you don't directly interfere with somebody else's freedom. Now, if they did, which would never last because of reasons I've said before, that once you give people power over you, they're going to take more and more power. So that could never happen. But maybe it could last for, I don't know, 10 years or something, or a small period of time. But that's what I believe in. Anyway, this Steen Jacobson, he's Danish, so I can't read his fucking name. He said he believes a social contract, the agreement between the ruled and the rulers, is now broken and can be seen in the rise of Donald Trump. So this is why Hillary cannot win. Now, the person that's going to win is whoever the powers that be, meaning the billionaires, the corporations, the secret societies, all the people that run all this shit, whoever they want to be president is who's going to be president. And maybe Donald Trump is all a sham and he'll end up president and he'll become a dictator, but he'll be a dictator controlled by these powers that be. And I wouldn't be surprised if that happens. It's going to be one or the other. Either way, doesn't matter. We're fucked. So this whole thing about the social contract, and that was the focus to me about this, although it doesn't get mentioned that much, but it's saying that's why people are voting for Donald Trump, because he is an outsider. And here's a quote. Hillary Clinton cannot win the U.S. election. She is the epitome of the establishment class, of the elitist order, which is true. He said, Trump, on the other hand, is so far away from being a politician that he represents chaos in a world of order, and this is what U.S. voters want. And that's a fucking sham right there. You're going to tell me a billionaire who's given to all these campaigns and has run all these businesses and is part of the business elite. Yes, he's not technically a politician, but look at the CFR. They're not really politicians neither. They're a bunch of billionaires. Who really runs everything? A bunch of billionaires. So what the fuck is the difference? There is none. It's a sham. It's a almost calculated thing, and I don't know, you know, who knows? It may have been Trump may be in there and may have asked to, either he was tricked into it or he's part of it to purposely get the people stirred up. Maybe they have it set up for him to become president to calm the people down that are upset about government. It's a vicious circle, because people keep saying, oh, you get the right person in there or you follow the Constitution, everything will be great. Like the cycles of between Democrats and Republicans, they keep going back and forth. And now it's, oh, well, we'll put somebody who's not part of the establishment, Trump, we'll put him in, and then you'll get the same results. It doesn't matter. You're going to get the same results, because the person that's going to end up in there is going to be controlled by the system and installed by the system in the first place. But going back to this social contract, which to me is the most fucking ridiculous thing, because the social contract is essentially saying that you have some kind of responsibility to government to obey its laws and to pay your taxes, and that you're part of this society, like you have a choice. First of all, people are either, well, let's look at the people in America. The majority of people are just born here. They just wake up one day and they consciously realize that they're, you know, because when you're a baby and you come out, you have no memory of that. And I don't know how cognitive you are. I remember my first memory was maybe like 2.5 or something. So whatever. At some point you realize that, okay, you're in this country, the United States. You don't know anything about any fucking social contract. You know that you were born and you're just here. You came out of your mother and whatever. You had no choice in that. You had nothing. And you're expected from the beginning, well, I don't know about the beginning, because maybe when you're an infant, but you're expected at a certain point, probably by 3 or 4, probably by 3, I would say. I know at 2, your parents are yelling at you, you know, to not do this and not do that. And I know they call them the terrible 2s, but they have preschools at 3, which they want to make a mandatory thing where the government covers it, that it's like public schools, because they want to get you even earlier and get a hold of your mind and corrupt it and brainwash it and all of that stuff. But at what point do you agree to this social contract? So people will say, well, my parents agreed to the social contract. Well, okay. And how did they? Because they went through the same thing. Or when you turn 18, what? If you don't leave? So even if you base it upon that, that once you turn 18, you're agreeing to the social contract because you don't leave. Well, where the fuck are you going to go anyway, first of all? But if you say that, then what about all the stuff that happens prior to turning 18 where you have to follow all these laws? Not only, I mean, I feel bad for teenagers now. It just gets worse and worse for them because they have to deal with all the shit that adults have to deal with regarding the government. And on top of it, they have to deal with their parents, and then they have to deal with additional government rules and regulations. So, and nobody stands up for teenagers, because once people get older, they forget about it. They don't care anymore. You know, all that stuff where there's a lot of people that when they were teenagers were rebels or young adults, and then they grow up and then they don't care about that stuff anymore, which is pretty fucked up because, oh, I'm past that. So, you know, I don't really care. Or I guess maybe some of them that have kids may care, but most of them don't want their kids acting like that anyway. So they're against it. So either way, the kids are out there with no funding really to fight anything. They can't vote. Not that that fucking matters anyway. So it's just a point to bring up that, okay, they can't vote. But that doesn't make a fucking difference. But why should they not be able to vote and let their vote, their useless vote count just as much as everybody else's, which is zero? Why don't they get to go through that process? Seriously, why not 14 or 13 get to have a say? Well, they don't want them to have a say because, of course, you know, politicians don't want to be catering to 13 or 14 year olds. But they're in a society where they don't even have a vote. And again, it doesn't matter. Nobody's vote fucking matters. But supposedly they'll tell you it does. But they don't get one. So they get screwed over more than anybody. And then you spend 18 years somewhere and you're supposed to find some other place to go based on what and with what money. And how do you even know that there's another place to go where you'd have more freedom and not have to agree to a stupid social contract? Because the social contract is not a contract. It's not a, you know, in contract law, they have something called consideration where both sides essentially consent and get to a deal is kind of, you know, offered there on both sides. And there's nothing that the government does. First of all, it is, in my opinion, there's nothing that the government does for me and except take my money. But roads, just a reminder, gas taxes are supposed to pay for roads. Just so everybody knows that, even though they take that money probably and do other shit with it. But gas taxes, there's federal gas taxes. Where do those go? I don't know. Yeah, they're supposed to go to fix the roads. Obviously, they don't. And there are such things as private roads and private parking lots. If you look at things like housing communities, I guess it depends on the community, but gated housing communities, I think some of the gated housing communities are roads that they actually built themselves. And then they pay the HOA to maintain those roads. That's probably more the millionaire, you know, housing communities as opposed to the cheaper ones because they can't afford to, you know, maintain that, I would think. But I could be wrong. It could be more of them than I'm aware of. But there's roads in all kinds. I mean, there's roads within casinos. There's roads within, you know, parking lots. So this whole ridiculous thing like, well, the government, you know, gives you roads. Right. Well, I give them a lot more money than what should cover roads because my gas taxes, along with my fees for my registration and my license, which nobody should be getting anymore based on the fact that it's fraud. It's fraudulent. Because if you have license plate readers, license plates are not supposed to be there so they can be monitored by the police with license plate readers so they can track everywhere you go. License photos are not supposed to be taken so the government can put them in a database. Because if you don't post your picture anyplace else, which you shouldn't, of course, you know, I do, and part of that is because of the show. If it wasn't for the show, I would totally get off social media. Or at least if I was going to stop posting articles or things like that. If I was going to say, you know what, fuck this shit. People don't give a fuck anyway. They don't care about the show, which most people don't. And they don't read the stuff I'm putting out there. They just want to live in their little status world. And I don't give a fuck anymore. I would totally disappear off social media, at least as much as I could. Now, I know they maintain all that shit anyway, but why even bother with it? So my internet presence would be greatly reduced, essentially. So, well, at least the social media side. I mean, I can't say that I wouldn't go on the internet at all. Although I wish I could totally avoid that as well, to be honest with you. But the technology and the, you know, things like paying bills, well, I could go to money orders and cash and all of that stuff. But do I really care that they know the government is aware of what I'm paying for rent and my electric bill and stuff like that. Well, you're going to have that anyway, actually. So, and yeah, I do care to an extent because that's none of their business. But I think paying my bills online is not going to stop them being, you know, the government from getting any information that they can't get other ways. But definitely social media. So going back to people that aren't on social media and don't have any pictures posted, it's hard not to have a picture posted because if you're not posting it, unless you're a hermit and you live in the middle of nowhere and live totally off the grid, there's other people that are probably posting pictures of you online. And I don't mean just of you, but if you're out with people and they take a picture and they'll post it online and they'll tag you in it and put your name on it, and great, give more information to the government. So you don't even have to do things yourself. Of course, there's cameras everywhere, there's all of that. So, but I guess that's all part of the social contract. So you're talking about a contract that you can't agree to because technically, because it's constantly changing anyway. So, I mean, you can agree to what it is right now if you had about 10 years to sit and read through every law and understand it. But think, by the time you did that, there'd be 10 more years worth of laws. So how do you agree, if you think of a contract, any other type of contract, right? If you buy a car, if you buy anything, usually buying stuff, but you make a deal with somebody, you take out a loan, you agree to pay them back within this amount of time. Everything is spelled out specifically. It's not really open into interpretation. It's pretty much you get this and they get that. And even if they mislead you, you're able to sue them. So the government not only misleads you all the time, but they don't even follow their own laws or obey their own laws. Or even when they charge you, they charge people with things that aren't crimes. I've been charged with things that aren't crimes, or convict you of crimes that you're not guilty of knowingly. They don't even follow their own, I guess, what would be the other side of the contract. And what's the side? See, that's from what I learned what consideration is, though, that you get something out of it, that you're getting – you can't have a contract and get nothing out of it, essentially. That's the whole point of a contract, that you get this for this, because what's the point of signing a contract for nothing? And I think right now – that's what it is. And not only that, but there is no contract. There is no agreement. There is no, I'm part of your society, so I have to agree, because you have no choice in being part of society. You have one, again, if you're not 18, you're stuck with your parents. And if you are, where the fuck you gonna go? Now, there's some states that are freer than others, and that's why I'm in Nevada and not fucking Massachusetts. But there's no state that's truly free. I don't know any country that's truly free. I don't know anywhere in the world that things are based on natural law, and that as long as you don't interfere, directly interfere with somebody else's freedom, you can do whatever you want. because it's your life, it's your body, it's your pursuit of happiness, and your right to pursue that happiness, as long as that happiness does not attack directly somebody else's happiness. And I always say directly because, you know, upsetting people or them getting offended or anything like that, that's irrelevant. That's their fucking emotional problem or whatever. As long as you do not physically attack them or you do not steal their property or take property of theirs that is not yours to take or damage, then you are free to do what you want. Now, I know people could come up with examples of, okay, what about if you jump in the middle of the road, or what if you yell fire in a movie theater? And I love how people use that as, you don't really have full freedom of speech. They use that fucking with the Second Amendment too, that they'll say, well, you don't have total freedom of speech. You can't yell fire in a movie theater. Those people, first of all, don't understand what freedom of speech represents, first of all, because freedom of speech doesn't represent just uttering fucking words. It represents the ideas, the ability to have the freedom to express whatever ideas you want, whether it's political speech or hate speech, if you want to call it that, or whatever kind of speech you want to express. It's the expression that means something. It's not the just uttering fucking words doesn't really, and you have the freedom to utter meaningless words, but that's not the purpose and behind freedom of speech. And the other thing is that all of these freedoms do not come from government. They come from you being a human or from God or however you want to look at it. But it does not come from government. What it was supposed to be, supposedly, was government was just supposed to protect those rights. And that's what people say the purpose of government is, to protect your freedoms. And I say that's bullshit. It was never the point of government. It was never the purpose of government. The purpose of government is to rule over people and control them and to take as much money and power as you can. That's the purpose of government. It's about, I've said this so many times, look up the fucking definition and you'll see how many times power is or control is mentioned. Because that's what government is. It's control. It's not protection. It's not protection of your rights. They're the ones you got to worry about taking your rights. And that's what they're doing right now. And they've taken fucking who knows how many. Or I don't know if you could say they've taken them, but they will come after you with guns if they're aware that you do certain things that you as a human being have the right to do. So how people can buy into this, and people buy into it, this social contract that they believe that, yes, I have a social contract with the government. Notice the government changes it every day. They're changing this social contract, this supposed social contract you have with them. They're making changes to it every day. Every day it's something different. It's a new law getting passed. I don't know if literally every day, but if you looked at federal, your state, your local community, it might be, you know, almost every day, that something or a judge is making a ruling that sets precedent, which somehow that becomes a law. I mean, it doesn't become law in the same sense, but it's used later to prosecute or defend a case. Then, of course, you have all of these agencies that make law. They would say, no, they don't make law. They're just making rules. What's the fucking difference? Rulers make rules. Rules are laws. It's the same. It's just semantics. It's, well, these are rules. Well, what's the fucking difference? If the government can enforce them, which they can, and everything is enforced by the barrel of a gun. So the social contract is, I will obey, or you can fucking kill me, cage me, or do anything you want, really, if I don't follow your ever-changing laws. What kind of fucking, who would in their right mind agree to something like that? Nobody. Nobody was alive when the Constitution was written. And the majority of laws, 99.9% of the people had nothing to do with. So this ridiculousness that somehow there's a social contract is just, it exists as a way to brainwash people into thinking that they have an obligation to the government, that you have a contract with the government. The government has no obligation to you, but you somehow have an obligation to the government. And now they keep saying it's to protect you, to protect, everything's to protect you. You're a little fucking kid. Look, I've said a million fucking times, I don't need protection. Okay? I'll protect myself, and hey, if that doesn't do the job and I get killed, then whatever, I get killed. But the government, the police, and all these government agencies are more of a threat, as far as I'm concerned, to my safety than anybody else. Because if a criminal tries to rob me, I have the right to defend myself against them. If a government official tries to rob me, which they do on a daily basis, I'm supposed to sit there and say thank you, or they'll most likely kill me. But I'm even saying if a government official tries to literally rob me at gunpoint, like a cop, which I'm sure they do all the time. Of course, they probably try to keep it limited to people they consider criminals and drug dealers and stuff like that because it's easier for them to get away with it. But they could get away with taking money out of your wallet. There's a lot of stories of people. I know there was one with an old lady, but of there's not as many as probably there really are because they never come out. But there's been some stories that have come out about the cops trying to rob somebody, or, you know, where they won money gambling and were driving somewhere and in the middle of nowhere. And, oh, we're going to take your money or we're going to arrest you. You're a drug dealer. Oh, it doesn't matter that you won money at the casino. So it just, it makes me sick, literally, that people can call this or mention social contract. And this writer saying, well, the social contract is, what was it? I want to get the exact quote again. That the social contract, the agreement between the ruled and the rulers, is now broken. Well, who decided it was broken? Who decided it existed in the first place? Because I have no social contract with the government. It's mine is broken and it has been broken. It never existed in the first place because it reminds me of Chasing Amy when he draws a thing of Santa Claus, the Easter Bunny. He says the friendly man, friendly lesbian, and the man hating lesbian, and which one gets to the $100 first. And he says the man hating lesbian, and then why? Because, not that I believe in that part of it, but because the other three don't exist. It doesn't exist. There is no social contract. There is a group of people, I guess, or in big entity or a big corporation that calls themselves the government, who are armed to the teeth, who rule by one thing, not a fucking social contract. Weapons and people to shoot and press buttons to fire those weapons. That's what it's based on. It's not a social contract. It's threat of violence. So there's the threat of violence. The agreement between the ruled and the rulers is if you obey us, we probably won't fucking kill you and ruin your life. Probably, but, you know, we could fuck up and, you know, do that. Or, you know, we poison all the food and we do all this other stuff too. So, you know, either way, you're going to get, but at least we won't just blow your brains out. So I'm going to take a quick break. Again, the number is 702-470-7664, 702-470-7664, or you can call in on Skype, Nonpartisan Liberty for All. It's one word. And give your thoughts. If you want to bring up something else, that's fine as well. Or give your thoughts on a social contract or what we're about to talk about after the break, believing in all the things that I basically just said, and then how that affects your life, how that would affect kids and a wife and family and what people think of you and all of that stuff, which, again, we talked a little about that before, but we kind of kept it to just dating. So we're going to go beyond that when we come back. So we'll be right back after this. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. Check us out.
The social contract is a concept that liberals and conservatives interpret very differently. Those who consider themselves liberals tend to use the term in a positive sense to encompass ideas of social responsibility and social justice, both of which are loaded terms in their own right. Conservatives tend to interpret the social contract as an extension of collectivism and therefore view it as an invalid and tyrannical construct. Most of the time, this debate doesn't go far beyond these two multiple choice options. And that's unfortunate because this is a false dichotomy. There are more than two ways of looking at this. Like it or not, the way that we conceive of the social contract, or the lack thereof, has a massive influence on the way society is organized. So it's in our best interest to re-examine our assumptions on this topic. So what is a social contract? The short answer is that the social contract is a set of expectations established by and enforced by a group onto its members. The term was first popularized by the French philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau during the Enlightenment period. Rousseau's concept of the social contract was unapologetically collectivism by force. He proclaimed that individuals should merge their rights and their will to society at large for the greater good, and that those who did not bend to the will of the majority should be forced to submit. Rarely are modern proponents of the social contract as honest as Rousseau was, but in practice, nothing's really changed. In modern times, if the majority, or more accurately, the elected officials of a majority, wish to establish public programs and need to fund those programs, it's generally understood that this will be made possible through taxation. Of course, people who buy into this line of thinking promote the idea that people should happily pay these taxes. After all, it is our duty. There's that social contract that we're all part of. But the unspoken reality here is that those who aren't enthusiastic volunteers will be forced to pay. And if you refuse, you'll have your property confiscated and or be thrown into a cage for a decade or two. No big deal, right? Now, the current way that most people frame this debate is a false dichotomy because though the political right does not acknowledge it, the fact of the matter is that they have their own version of the social contract. And philosophically, it's identical at its core. The majority of the political right supports forced taxation. They just have a different concept of where this stolen money should be spent. They also support collectivism by force in the form of the legislative, executive, and judicial systems, though they don't generally see it as such. The problem here is that people aren't being honest about the implications of their politics. The social contract, as it is right now, is a set of rules imposed by force upon people who are given no choice to opt out. And those rules change constantly because new laws are being written all the time. It is assumed that if you are born within a specific country, the government ruling that geographical region has the right to impose requirements and restrictions on your life. Whether we're talking about forced taxation, compulsory schooling, registering for a military draft, or mandatory vaccinations, the underlying issue is the same. Now, conservatives tend to refer to the Constitution as the point of reference with the assumption that this changes the dynamic, but it really doesn't. The Constitution is often referred to as a document designed to restrict government. But what most people overlook is the fact that the Constitution was first and foremost used to create government, with the understanding that this government would have power over the citizens. But did the people who wrote the Constitution have the right to give the government that power? In order for a contract to be valid, those who it claims to bind must agree to it in full awareness of the terms. In other words, there must be informed consent. Any contract that fails to meet these conditions is invalid, and therefore has no real or legitimate power, even if that contract is well written and noble in its intentions. A group of men 200 years ago sitting down and writing a document cannot hand power to a government today to seize your property by force or put you in jail for smoking a joint or regulate how you build your house. Obviously, these kinds of laws were not the original intention of the founders, but the federal government itself owes its existence to the Constitution. In fact, this was the explicit reason why the Constitution was created. It replaced the Articles of Confederation, which was much more decentralized in nature. So even though the federal government is clearly abusing its power, its claims of legitimacy are rooted in the Constitution. So it's extremely important to question whether that claim is valid. Some use vague notions of democracy to try to get around this issue, but this really doesn't hold up. If 11 people are in a room and 10 people vote to take the 11th person's wallet and distribute its contents, is this valid? If not, then why would it be valid on a larger scale? Even if 100% of the population viewed the electoral process as legitimate and participated, which is clearly not the case, it still wouldn't change the underlying morality. Theft is theft, regardless of how popular it is. Now, on the other side of this, all societies gravitate towards rules. Humans tend to want structure. They want violent crime to be dealt with consistently and justly. They want certain activities like child slavery and child pornography to be prohibited. And most people don't want their neighbor to be dumping poisons into the ground that seep into the water table. This tendency to want to establish societal norms will manifest whether you like it or not, and regardless of whether you see deep philosophical problems with it or not. And to be honest, there are philosophical problems here. But in practical terms, we have to deal with people as they are, not as we wish they would be. Therefore, the question is really how this tendency will manifest and how we deal with it. In the current paradigm, both the political left and the political right endorse collectivism by force, without informed consent. So what would be the alternative? How can we address this tendency towards societal rules without degrading into what we have now? Say a group of people establish a club, and with it, a set of rules, and they open up membership to the public. If the rules were clear and membership is voluntary, then this would be a valid arrangement, as long as the members could choose to walk away at any time. If we were to talk about this on a societal level, membership would be citizenship. Of course, this implies that citizenship and the duties and or protections that may come with it cannot be imposed upon a child and then assumed to be valid through that person's adulthood. Citizenship must be a conscious choice made in full awareness of the terms. Parents cannot make that decision for their children, at least not for their whole lives. Nor would it be legitimate from this perspective to have a gaggle of so-called lawmakers writing new laws willy-nilly. Writing new laws changes the terms of the contract. Changing the terms of the contract inherently invalidates that contract unless people voluntarily sign on to the new terms. Now, this is a radically different way of looking at human societies, and it is not something that could just be superimposed over our current system. In fact, fully coming to terms with its implications would inherently break the current system.
And that is one of the best points there. Well, I mean, there's a lot of good points. And the point being what he said, and which what I mentioned as well, is that you're changing the terms of the contract constantly. So if there is a quote unquote social contract, within the social contract is the agreement that the government will change it at any time for any reason. It's ridiculous. It's like there was another analogy that I can't think of right now where, you know, property taxes, which is obviously part of the government, same thing. They can up property taxes anytime they want, force you to pay them, and you basically enter into this contract, essentially. I mean, it, as far as I know, it doesn't say anything about property taxes and the ability to raise them anytime for whenever we feel like it when you buy a house and sign the papers. I don't remember that being in there, but of course I didn't read the whole thing because it's, you know, I don't know how many pages. But yeah, I mean, you can't buy a house without the government being able to raise your property taxes at any time for any reason. And what kind of fucking contract is that? You don't own your house. You lease it from the government.
Because with it comes the realization that the government is operating on an invalid contract, and their so-called authority is little more than a self-serving fantasy. Once you see that, why would you obey them? In the early stages, you may give in out of fear of their enforcers. But when the enforcers begin to wake up, it's over.
Exactly. That's why. Fear their enforcers. Most people, and this is why they used to say, you know, not knowing the law is not an excuse for not, you know, following it, because it used to be based on natural law, which is what I say, basically, that you can do whatever you want as long as you don't interfere with somebody else's freedom. Everybody knew what was wrong. You don't kill people. You don't hurt people. You don't steal from them. And everything else, you can do whatever you want. But really, most people, the majority of people, would follow that. What people don't want to follow are these ridiculous laws that the government passes that have no basis in anything but control.
This whole topic may seem to you like a pointless philosophical exercise, but consider for a moment where we are headed as a society. All empires fall, and the United States is on its deathbed. The entire planet is going to be destabilized when this comes down. Many nations will collapse. How are we going to rebuild? Are we going to blindly recreate the current system from the same flawed paradigm? Or worse, do it on a global scale? Or will we learn from our mistakes? If you care about the world you're passing on to your children, it's worth thinking deeply about this right now.
Disclaimer, not everyone is going to like this video. My intention, though, is not to offend anyone. Please do not take it personally. If you know you're a super sensitive person, you should probably just click away. There's going to be some tough love, brutal honesty, because I do want to help people. And in order to do that, I need to keep it real and not sugarcoat things. You might ask, what does libertarianism and dating have to do with each other? Why am I making this video? I get a lot of messages asking, how can I find a libertarian girlfriend? Where do I meet libertarian women? I am not OkCupid, but I do have some advice if you care to listen. If you don't, about a dozen or so other libertarian women helped me with ideas for this video. Thank you. Some of these apply to both sexes, but as a heterosexual woman, I'm more familiar with one side. Let's begin. Dating is a free market. There's a lot of competition out there, but there are steps you can do to make yourself more in demand. Be confident, but not snooty. Women love confident guys. It's been said a million times, but it's true. It's how you present yourself. Good posture, head up, walking with a purpose. If you look confident and you're secure with who you are, you're like a magnet. Women are like, hey, I want to be around that guy. Probably not like that, though. That was weird. If you're awkward like me, sometimes you just have to fake it and realize that most other people are faking it too. But don't be snooty. I bet she's never even heard of Rothbard. People who watch the Super Bowl disgust me. How can they watch a game when our liberties are being destroyed? So ignorant. These sheeple need to wake up and get on my level. That kind of attitude makes people not want to be around you because your presence is miserable and it's bumming me out. Know thy difference between nice guy and pushover. I hear all the time, women only like jerks. Not really, though. Some women like guys who treat them badly. Well, that's a certain kind of woman, and she got issues herself that she needs to work on. Low self-esteem, low self-worth. Women who are mentally healthy, they like nice guys who treat them well. Nice guys are supportive, encouraging, dependable, but they also have a backbone. They aren't afraid to stand up for themselves and tell you no when you're being ridiculous. I should know. Pushovers are passive, pitiful, desperate, yes men, not attractive.
Good afternoon, my lady. Yes, 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 I will defend your honor.
Don't be one-dimensional. Now, it's perfectly fine to be a libertarian, to be passionate about it. I am too. But there is a line where it completely takes over your life and entirely defines you as a person, and you lose yourself. I see it on Facebook all the time where people's middle name is Voluntarist or Liberty. They have no pictures of themselves. It's all political philosophers as their profile pictures. Everything they post is somehow related to libertarianism. You don't want to be on a date and this happens. What are your hobbies?
Libertarianism, libertarians, liberty.
Be a more well-rounded person. Have more interest. It will make you more interesting. Don't focus so much on finding a libertarian partner. There's just not that many libertarians out there, especially female libertarians. You're really, really going to limit yourself if being a libertarian is a dating requirement for you. Plus, this whole, I want a libertarian girlfriend, it comes across as some kind of prize instead of a person. You know, there's much more to compatibility than political views. It's not like,
yeah, she's great. She wants to end the Fed and legalize raw milk. We're perfect for each other.
Other factors come into play. Now, I understand not wanting to date an outspoken socialist or something. You gotta have some standards, okay? But I say be open to people who may be politically apathetic. Who knows? You may be able to introduce them to libertarian ideas and get them to come your way. But don't push it. If not, there's so many other people you can find to talk to about libertarianism. I don't think your partner necessarily needs to be involved in every single thing you are. How they live their life, I would say, is more important than political labels or interest. Have realistic expectations. Goes for both sexes. If you're like, well, I'm only single because I don't want to date anyone less than a 10 on the hotness and intellectual scale.
Right.
Be realistic about it. Someone with supermodel looks, Jeffrey Tucker's charm, Mises' smarts, Peter Schiff's money, probably doesn't exist. Improve yourself. Too many people on both sides blame the opposite sex solely for their singleness. There's no good men out there, they're all scumbags. Maybe it's you.
Stop being creepy.
Let's talk about my inbox. People sending me pics of their junk. Unsolicited, mind you.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back in a calmer mood, I guess, after that rant. And I really wasn't, I guess you could say that's yelling, but that's probably as loud as I get. Or because the show, I've mentioned this before, is it's not about that. It's not about really, I mean, I get angry about things, but it's not about yelling and cursing people out and things like that. It's more about getting the message across. But I'm passionate about a lot of these things. And a lot of times it is frustrating to talk about them and think about them. And that kind of leads into our next topic. The, you know, living and being happy and having a life and a family and all of these things, when you know that you live in a society that is not free and that it's only getting worse. And, you know, I played that half of that clip from Julie Borowski about, you know, libertarian dating. It was funny because she did mention, you know, if that's all you talk about or whatever. And I could see myself, to be honest, not everything she said, but some of the things where when I go out and I'm around people I don't know, especially, I mention things a lot, we'll put it that way. It depends on what comes up. I don't just blurt something out, and it probably doesn't come off that well. You know, you got to do it in a way that is more interesting and conversational, like a friendly conversation, but at the same time informing somebody of what's going on. And I've done that before as well, but to do it in a total negative way. And sometimes it's hard not to, because again, of what's going on. So if I, you know, ever end up dating again, if things don't work out in my current relationship, I don't know that I will, because I don't know how I'd even like how I'd even find a girl that would be okay with all these things. And if it was somebody that I was gonna, you know, marry or have kids with or something like that, because I did a show a couple nights ago about schools, and it's just with what goes on in schools and making sure that, you know, your kids are homeschooled. I mean, that alone, I'm sure, would drive away a bunch of girls, or they may be like, hey, I want to stay home. So, but there are a lot more career oriented women or women that don't want to stay home with the kids. I think it's the responsibility of somebody. And I don't necessarily think it has to be the woman, but this whole government babysitting, which is what government schools is to me, is bullshit and it should not exist. That if you decide to have kids, you should be in a situation where one of the parents, and again, it doesn't have to be the woman. Hey, if the woman has a better career and makes more money, and that's okay with within the relationship, like that's, they both agree that, hey, she'll work and I'll stay home. I don't see any problem with that. Usually there is biology that comes into it, that women bond more because they have the baby within them, and that more women tend to want to stay home with their kids than men. And people, you know, they want to ignore those type of things. But there are women that are more career driven that don't even want to have kids just because they want a career and they don't want to anything to interfere with that at all, which is totally understandable. So this is not a feminist or anti-feminist or whatever thing. This is one of the parents should be home with the kids. And that's just, to me, bottom line. But you have all these things that come up. I mean, when you're by yourself, and I mean not in a relationship and you don't have any kids, the effects are, you know, a lot less. Like, okay, it could affect you getting a job depending on what you're doing. And I mean, I'm not talking about doing anything illegal, but if you're protesting on the news or something, or doing a show, but my show is so small that, you know, and I don't know that even if people, because there are some people that at work that listen to the show and are aware of it. Actually, there are a lot of people that are aware of it. I think they just never heard it, so they don't care. but I mean, I don't mention my company or anything like that. So pretty much, I think, as long as you're not doing anything illegal, although that may happen in the future, because if they keep passing these laws that are ridiculous, you know, I promote noncompliance and not obeying them. And I'm not talking about laws that hurt anybody. I'm talking about victimless crimes and really crimes on, I don't want to say citizens, crimes on people that live within the country. You know, things like adding a mileage tax to your registration, and every year the amount of miles you drive, you got to pay a tax on it, or things along those lines, and saying, finally drawing a line and saying, hey, I'm not complying with this. But you have the, I guess, social stigma of it. If you're vocal to friends and family, some of them are going to think you're nuts, or some of them are going to push you away or reject your thoughts, or maybe not even want to have anything to do with you based on your beliefs when it comes to things like that, which I think is insane, because they're really the ones that are the ignorant ones. And I know that kind of sounds arrogant, but it's to not at least be open-minded or even listen, or to push somebody away because of that, I think it is crazy. But I guess I'd understand if they're worried about, well, but this is kind of even worse. If they're worried about, well, I don't want to be associated with you because the things you say, the government could be watching you, or I could be on a list because of you, or something like that. But that's like totally selling out in a way, saying that I know, because obviously if you think that, then you know that the government is fucked up, and saying that, hey, I just want to follow what the government says, and, you know, I'll have, as long as I do that, I'll be okay. The thing is, that's not the case. If you just sit there and just keep obeying the government, for one, there are plenty of innocent people who have been killed, beaten, went to jail for, and I'm not even talking about people in the wrong place at the wrong time, like, that put themselves in the wrong place at the wrong time or hung around bad people or anything like that. I mean, there's been warrants served to the wrong house plenty of times where people have had those experiences, and even people have gotten killed that way. So, and that's just one example. But when it comes to kids, because I think even if you can find somebody who has your same point of view and supports you and respects your same point of view, I think even that is not that hard if you can find them. I think finding them might be hard, especially, you know, I guess it depends how far you go, meaning how far your beliefs go. And I totally don't believe in government, period. So I would be on the extreme. If there's a scale, I'm not a limited government person. I'm not a minarchist. I'm totally, I believe in an organized society, but I believe that people should have control over their own lives and their own destiny. And that if government could just maintain making sure and punishing people for murder and robbery and property theft and things like that, then I may say, okay, I believe in limited government. But I realize, which most people that don't believe in government do, is that it's never going, you can't maintain that. And it's been proven over and over again. And look at the U.S. as a perfect example. So, and on the other side of that is, why give people power over you? Why? If you can do things for yourself and protect yourself, and there's people that people think that because there are some bad people out there, and I believe that the government has helped to distance people, to separate people, to get people to hate each other. Like they're trying to get, you know, they classify everybody and they want black versus white and Republican versus, well, that's a little different because that's like a fucking wrestling type thing. But they want, well, no, with Republican versus Democrat, not the actual politicians, but the people, they get them fighting amongst each other over something where the actual politicians are friends. It's fucked up. So they want to put people and classify them into all these little groups and have them fighting amongst each other instead of getting together. Because the more you separate people, the more you, like they're trying to do now with race, because it's the government who's been most oppressive to black people. Well, the government. Or Hispanic people, or white people, for that matter. The most oppressive organizations are all government organizations. So if people, instead of focusing on race and religion and stupid political party, really just dumped the political party and got together. And it doesn't mean you have to personally hang out with them or like them or whatever, but banded together for a common goal, there's more of us than there is of the government. So when it comes to the easiest way, in my opinion, to change a law is noncompliance. You get 20,000 people in Vegas to stop putting, you know, to rip off their license plates and not register their car. Really? They're going to arrest and tow every single one of them's car? It's not going to happen. Because they can't even physically do it. What's going to happen is they're going to have to rethink their laws. Or they, if they want to, I guess they can go all out and bring in the military and then martial law, and then it's total all-out war. But I mean, for something like that, and you know what, for something like that, maybe they do it, because everything is based off obedience now. They push obedience. It doesn't matter what you did. Being disobedient is worse than like stealing from somebody in a court, as long as you're you know, you apologize and you're not forgiveful. The later it gets, the harder it is for me to think of words that I want to say. As long as you you feel bad about it and wish you didn't do it and are regretful, then that person is not as bad as the person who just didn't obey an order from a cop in their eyes, because it's obedience. And the people that aren't obedient are the people that are dangerous, the people that speak out and try to defy or question or tell the truth. Those are the people. So when you're, you know, by yourself, it's really only going to affect you. And when, you know, as I was saying, if you can find somebody who has those similar views, like I was saying, I'm way over here, but, you know, somebody who supports that and believes in those same things, I think that that's a relationship that can work out and you can be happy as well. Of course, you know, happy about the relationship, but not necessarily happy about what's going on. But you can feed off each other. And, you know, the same way as having, you know, living in a community like the whole thing with the Free State Project, who fuck them. But say New Hampshire, for example, where, you know, meeting a whole bunch of people that have similar views to yours. But then, you know, and so even getting married in marriage, a lot of people are against it because it's a state institution. It's basically having the government or getting government approval or government recognition is really what it is. But it does cover you in certain things. So I can understand that. But if things happen, unfortunately, you know, I guess you could get legal documents, but it's just, what's the difference? You're still going through the government's stupid system to assign legal or create legal documents that would be the same as getting married. So I can understand that. And I think something like that can work. When you have kids, that's when things, I think, can get very complicated and very scary and possibly dangerous in some ways. And I'll get into how later. But so, one, if you're not both on the same page, you might be able to, again, get away with getting married and your relationship still work. But if you have kids, that's probably going to, that possibly could be the end of your relationship, or at least the cause for a lot of disagreements. And that's not good for the kids neither, because as someone who is anti-government, you want to keep your kids out of their systems as much as possible. And let them choose when they, you know, you can't really let them choose at like 3 years old, but let them make their decisions when they get to that point. And I think at, you know, it's hard to think of an age to think back when I was a kid, but maybe 8, 9, or 10, as far as where, if they want to go to an actual school, although I would advise against it. But I believe in bringing up kids freely and peaceful parenting. And I don't know how exactly to, you know, I guess you kind of learn as you go. That's what parents do. But I know you have to be way more involved, first of all, if you're bringing up your kids in a free atmosphere. Like, I don't believe in discipline. As far as disciplining kids, I believe in self-discipline, but I don't believe in disciplining kids. Now, if you're not going to discipline your kids, you still have to teach them right from wrong. And how do you do that? And you need to explain to them why. That whole thing, because I said so, it doesn't fly, because what it does is it just teaches them more obedience. Just like the government, because I said so. Now, how you apply that to a 2-year-old, that's another story. But there are people that have followed this form of parenting. And obviously, I would read their books. And I had Dana Martin on the show, who has brought her kids up this way. She's a radical unschooler. I think she has a book, and I would definitely talk to her and listen back to her interview, or maybe interview her again before I had kids. And the same thing with, they say, you know, if your kid's crying, just leave them there. They got to learn to be alone, like that whole thing. No, I don't believe in that neither. I do believe in the, and I think this came up last night, you know, how they have participation trophies and every kid gets one because, you know, the kids will get all upset and cry and whatever. I do believe that kids need to know how to take care of themselves. But that's what that does. I mean, that's not babying them. You're only, I guess, babying them when they're an actual baby if you pick them up when they cry. But as they get older, you let them build responsibility by letting them make their own choices and their own decisions. Now, again, I believe that you have to be very involved. And I'm basing this off of what I believe along with my childhood. I know I don't have kids, so people are going to say, you don't know what the fuck you're talking about. You don't have kids. But people that do have kids have followed this form of parenting. And at least to this point, they have teenagers already, and they have turned out fine. So following their model, I mean, not exactly. I'll take different things from different people. Of course, never hitting kids. What does that do? That's the same, to me, rationale of the state. And then homeschooling them. As far as the radical homeschooling where they dictate what they want to learn, I think you need a little of that, but I still would bring in things that I think that are necessary, like, you know, math and things like that, if it wasn't something that they brought up. You definitely need to learn, I think, certain things. But I'd still try to do it in a way where it was their decision. And, you know, I wouldn't go to the extent, and this is no insult to Dana. She is definitely a radical unschooler. You know, there's unschooling, which is, that's what it is. It's the kids kind of dictate what they want to learn. And then radical unschooling, and she's definitely, you know, on a scale of 1 to 10, she's the 20. And that's fine. Her kids seem to be fine. They end up, I mean, they follow their own interests. They follow what they want to do. Now, again, there's basic things that I think you need to learn, but I had talked about even in schools, I mean, they teach in a way to dumb the kids down. So they teach, just take reading, for example. How many people, after they get out of school, want to read? Not a lot, especially these days. I found myself recently, before I started doing the show, I was reading like crazy because I wanted, you know, all this information about all these things that were going on, that the things I wasn't aware of. You know, I read Radley Balco's book about the rise of the warrior cop. I read The Rise of the Fourth Reich by Jim Mars. I read, what was Jim Mars's other book? Some other book Jim Mars wrote, Government of Wolves by John Whitehead, who I'm trying to get on the show. There was a whole bunch of the one about the Federal Reserve by G. Edward Griffin. So many books that I would read, and I felt like if it was, I wouldn't even read fiction books because I felt like if I'm not getting information out of this, then, you know, what's the point? I want to use my time to do that. And I started getting more books again, and of course, I'm still getting CDs too. You can get CDs from the library, brand new ones. But with the show, it makes it harder, and I got to push myself back into reading. But I remember when I was a kid, we had a summer reading list, and we had to read two books from the list. And it felt like, you know, we had the whole summer, like 3 months. And back then, when you're a kid, like junior high, man, the summer feels like forever. It feels like a year. You know, time goes by so much faster when you're older. And I know one time I didn't even read one of the books. And I think 1 year I might have just read one. And it was such a chore. And books, a lot of the time, are very, you know, if it's a sucky book, just like a movie. But, I mean, a book is just as informative or entertaining as a movie. You know, you could look at fiction as, you know, a regular movie, a full-length motion picture, and nonfiction as documentaries. And it essentially is just as entertaining or can be as TV or video games or anything else, any other form of entertainment. However, less and less people are reading. And with reading, it instills creativity because you get to imagine the characters if it's a fiction book, or you get to, even if it's nonfiction, you can imagine in your head what's going on and the situations and things along those lines. But for some reason, kids leave school and they don't want to read again. And I remember after I got my master's degree, I'm like, I didn't read for years, except, you know, maybe news articles. And why is that? It's because of the way they teach. They don't want you to want to read in the future. So they do it in a way that they cram things down your throat. They force you to read all the stuff that you don't want to. And I'm not saying that you shouldn't read some of the quote unquote classics, but it's like starting with the forcing people to read certain things, or to, you know, it's kind of like if you develop it on your own time, or I don't know the solution to coming up with somebody who loves reading or teaching a kid or getting somebody to love and appreciate reading. But I know it's not the way that schools teach it, and the way that they have you read chapters and chapters of your history book or of this book or that book. The amount of reading is ridiculous, for one, and they have you read all this boring shit that, you know, textbooks. And it's not even just that. It's the way textbooks are written. It's all of these things. So it's the form of teaching. And that's something that I didn't think a lot about until John Taylor Gatto recently. I listened to like a 3-hour interview. It was actually 3 interviews. And the one thing I didn't think of, I'm sure there's a lot of things I didn't think of, but that I just thought of this week after those interviews, was the method of teaching. Because he brought up an example of learning to drive a car and how he learned when he was like 12 or something. And he also had brought up teaching people time in Spanish or something. And that he could teach everybody in like 20 hours or something like that, that he had brought up. And that he had also brought up, I had mentioned, the guy from Stand and Deliver, Jaime, I can't think, Escalante. He taught advanced calculus to poor Latinos that come from very poor neighborhoods. And they were learning advanced calculus and passing the test. And so what his point was, is it's not just the curriculum and how they try to indoctrinate you and what they teach you. It's also how they teach you and how teachers have been trained and how they don't want anybody fucking with the method of teaching. If you try to do something different, you're out of there. Because they're trying to eliminate also kids' creativity. Because creativity is something that makes you think about all these ideas and how to do things differently and how things, you know, to question things and to think critically as well. So I never thought about the methods and how really I think the main design that is the dumbing down has to do with the methods. And if you think back to your school experience, try to think about that. You know, try to think about the methods that teachers use. And one I just thought of that I was just talking about is, you know, the reading of all these textbooks. And usually people wouldn't read them anyway. But think about how textbooks are designed in the first place. Anyway, I want to get back to homeschooling. So I believe in homeschooling and in letting kids make their own choices. They know. You can't tell me that even at 5 years old, and I'm not saying that, oh, a five-year-old should go out on their own, but I'm saying, you know, kids can make decisions like they know what their favorite color is or what they like to wear and what they don't like or what their food they like and all of these things that have formed pretty quick in a kid. And the goal to me is to have kids that can critically think, that challenged the system and are independent thinkers and do what they want to do and stand up for their principles. So, you know, what happens, I think, is parents, you know, discipline their kids, treat them worse than the government, which is pretty hard. Plus, at the same time, kids have to deal with schools and teachers and that discipline, which is ridiculous, the school discipline. And then also, you have all these laws and police harassing kids, and now you have police in the schools. So how do you expect your kid to grow up to be a free thinker? So to me, that is very important. And that's something that not only can cause problems in a relationship, it can also cause problems with family, friendship, and government. You can have the CPS investigate you. You can have neighbors calling, well, their kids are always home. I talked about neighbors, you know, watching my fucking animals, never mind having kids. So you could run into situations where you're being questioned by the government for bringing up your kids how you want to and really bringing them up as people, not as property. But right away, I mean, I have friends that have kids that are total disciplinarians. And I'll bring up any of this, and right away it's, no, they have to do this, and they have to do that. And they don't see any other side of it. They just believe that's how it is, and whether it probably came from their parents and how they were brought up. But it's sad because I really think, and I've mentioned this before, that when it comes to true freedom and liberty and obtaining it, which I think I'm not very optimistic, but I think one of the things and one of the ways there is the next generation. And if you can get the majority of kids out of government schools, and not into, you know, some people that homeschool, and this is a stereotype, like the religious freaks or evangelicals or whatever that are, you know, total disciplinarians and you have to obey God's law and all of this shit. That's not what I'm talking about. But by following not just homeschooling, but peaceful parenting and a non-disciplinary way of bringing up your kids and being more of a, I don't want to say advisor because that sounds weird, but really, like I said, you have to be more involved. You have to know about everything they're doing. And of course, if you're not punishing them, they're going to tell you about everything they're doing. They're going to build a trust with you where you, and I'm not just taking this from what I believe, I'm also taking this from other people who practice these methods, that and it makes sense that you're going to build a trust with them where they're going to tell you about everything they're doing. And they're going to know that you're being honest with them when you tell them things. And they are going to listen to you because they're going to take your advice. So it's not necessarily they're going to listen to you because they're afraid of getting punished. It's almost the same thing like as the government, where why do kids listen to their parents? Well, for most kids, like younger kids at least, they're afraid of getting punished, whether it's hit or grounded or their toys taken away. Why do you want to rule by fear? Because that's how the government does it. They rule by fear. Because really, if their laws were so great, and I'm not talking about natural law and the you know, not interfering with other people's freedom. I'm talking about all this other shit. Why would they have to be forced on people? Why wouldn't people just adopt them on their own? And they don't, because most of them are bullshit. And if they want to, they should have the freedom to. So the same with kids is that you teach them these things and they're their own people and they're going to develop into their own people. Just because you decided to have a kid does not mean you own your kid and you have some kind of say on their life when they're, you know, when they leave the house, because you don't. You do while they're there, but even there, even in that case, you don't own your kid. I know people think they do, but they're a person. And there's a selfish reason why people have kids, for their own benefits and in certain ways, you know, whether it's they just want to bring somebody up and you know, have that experience of having a kid and watching them grow up and teaching them things, whatever reason it may be, it's still selfish, not in a bad way, because you're bringing a life into the world, but you're getting something out of it as well. So sticking by those things, it's hard for the majority of people aren't going to agree with any of those. They're not going to say, no, we don't discipline the kids. It, you know, it might be easier to get women to adopt that type of thinking than men. So, which is good for me, because I think it would be easier to get a woman to agree to that type of upbringing than it would for a woman to get a man to agree. But that's kind of stereotyping, and I'm just saying in general. But yeah, to find somebody that would agree to all those things and say, yeah, I see what's going on, and I see how, you know, I respect my kids as people and I want them to be happy and have the best life possible and grow up as free as possible. Because what are you really, you know, what is the point of all that, of all the discipline and hitting? And because really all you're doing is it's just a delay of, they're not learning anything. They're learning that they need to hide things from you, or if they do certain things, they have to wait until they're 18. And then, you know, a lot of kids end up growing up all fucked up because depending on how hard the parents were when they were growing up and how strict they were. But to me, it's kids have to make their own mistakes. And it's hard to kind of, you know, I did a show on this and kind of just talk about these principles briefly. And I'm sure if anybody's listening who's an authoritarian, at least with their kids, you know, they're totally like, you don't know what the fuck you're talking about and this and that and whatever. And that's fine. And, you know, but one thing that you can't deny is that if you're a disciplinarian, if you pretty much have a lot of rules for your kids and that's how you bring them up, I mean, really, you're just handing them over to the government and, you know, it's one ruler to another. The parents are the rulers, but it's even more fucked up because, again, they have the parents, the schools, and the government all at the same time. So it's pretty bad. But, again, to get somebody to agree to that, and then you're also outcasted in certain neighborhoods where people would look at you like, oh, those are the homeschoolers. Those are the ones who don't really believe in discipline. Those are the ones who whatever. And as I mentioned earlier, that may cause them to call the CPS or call the police. I mean, we talked about how the police are arresting parents or arresting, putting kids in CPS custody for being at the park by themselves when they're 9 years old. So you open yourself up to all of those things as well, unless you're in, you know, a community where most of the people agree with you. I don't know how you accomplish that, you know, even in New Hampshire, I mean, they're all spread around the state. It's not like they're all on the same street. That would be something that I think would, to have a town and at least a couple streets within the town and everybody move, you know, buy up land and build houses and have a whole, you know, a liberty community, literally, I think would be a great thing. And that would, I think, help. But, you know, it would only do so much because you're still in a bigger community within a state. So, so after it being hard enough to meet somebody who just is okay with your beliefs on other things, then you have to find somebody who's okay with your beliefs on how to raise your kids. And then you still have the worry about, well, what happens when things get worse and people start standing up for themselves? Or, you know, you go out and protest and get arrested or killed. I mean, the way things are going now, you have plenty of unarmed people getting killed by the police. And things are, they're only going to get worse. So you also have that worry of, okay, well, I married somebody, we have kids, and I'm worried about, you know, even cracking down on, you know, they want to pass hate speech laws and all these the TPP with copyright laws on the internet and all these things that you could be arrested for or fined for. And then, you know, your significant other or partner would be worrying about things like that. So there's so many, I think, challenges really to not just date. I mean, dating's one thing, but marrying and having kids with somebody who has the type of beliefs that I have and who's not scared about vocalizing them on the internet, on a radio show. And right now, yeah, we're small, but maybe one day we get a lot bigger and we're a target. You know, like I believe Free Talk Live is a target. And I think that's what happened with them when They claim the FBI raided their studios and claim that it was because they went to a site that the FBI had their own child porn site that they took over when they busted somebody else and ran it for at least a couple weeks, and claim some computer from the studio or somebody went through the wireless or something like that. I'm not sure if it was the IP of a computer or the IP of a wireless, but either way, that happened and they seized all these computers. And I believe that the FBI either knows there's nothing there and is trying to shut down, thought they could maybe shut down the show by taking their equipment, or they're targeting them. They're going after them for speaking out, for talking about all these things that are going on with the government. And a week before, Mark, one of the co-hosts, said that had talked about how the FBI ran their own porn site for a couple weeks. So, and they're a nationally syndicated show on 170 stations. So I say that, it's like, okay, how many people are really hearing it? They say it, a lot of people are hearing it. So you have that worry of, okay, what happens if the government comes after us? What if they try to take our house away? What if they try to, you know, come after my husband? I'm saying that, you know, from the standpoint of my fiance or girlfriend or wife, you know, if I get married and I, you know, have a wife and she's saying, well, you know, I'm worried about all these things happening to my husband based on what he's saying on the radio. So, or just what he's posting on the internet. There's people that have gotten arrested for posts on the internet. So there's a lot of things that are just make it hard. And of course, when you have somebody who's saying, you know, who worries about that stuff, then they don't want you to do it. And they would probably try to talk you out of doing things. And, oh, we have kids. And what about me? And I'm currently engaged. And, you know, if we end up getting married and having kids, you know, I don't know that she's okay with all of these things. So it definitely, I think, would put a strain on the relationship. So, and it's fucked up because really all I'm trying to do is I felt that I couldn't sit there any longer and not say anything. So I could be quiet and just gather information and prepare for the worst. I could do that. But for me, I felt like I got to do something that reaches people. Even if it's not reaching a lot of people, even if it's not having an effect, I can't really, I think, I wouldn't say live with myself, but I don't know that I'd feel good about myself if I wasn't doing something. Although occasionally I think about how, you know, you get to the point where you're like, well, none of these people care anyway, so why bother? You know, and that I do think about a lot. I think about sometimes, well, none of these people give a fuck. They want to be slaves and, you know, who cares? Just give up at some point. So I don't know what, you know, of course, I'll always be, when I say give up, it doesn't mean I won't always be preparing and whatnot. But, you know, as far as trying to inform people and trying to wake them up and trying to let them know, hey, you know, get your kids out of government schools, learn what's going on, you know, get people together and don't comply with some of these ridiculous laws. And to get the hearts and minds of people, whether it's from me or somebody listens to me one day and they talk to a bunch of people, or, you know, And I've reached a couple people, and really, if I'm just reaching one person, and when I say reaching, I'm not talking about having one person listen. I mean, you know, influencing one person and letting them know, you know, what the truth about things, and getting them to research it, and them telling their friends, and then, you know, at least I'm accomplishing something. So I don't know, but it is hard, but I can't not, you know, I can't be somebody else. This is who I am. It's part of who I am. So for me, when it comes to whoever I'm with, my significant other, it's you accept it or don't be with me, really, because there's really no other option. So thanks, everybody, for tuning in. We'll be back on Tuesday. Check us out, NonPartisanLibertyForAll.com.
If you're white, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take it away. You're forced. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe.
Sometimes the use of force is necessary.